Hello and welcome. My name is Denzel Rodriguez, your personal finance geek of the 21st century. On this channel, we talk about and discuss and go over into detail with the numbers, everything down to the last penny. We talk about the velocity banking concept, the infinite banking concept, and kingdom authority. In today's video, we're going to be discussing the infinite banking concept. We're going to be going over the infinite banking process in 2021. According to how I like to do things, and to be super transparent, open, honest, and have a wonderful dialogue conversation in the comments below, I am going to share other people's processes. We're gonna look at the entire marketplace as of 2021. Currently, I did some research on my own to provide you a laundry list of resources, so you really can't go wrong, okay? Whether you choose to work with me or some of my affiliates or partners, or go a completely different route, I want you to know that we're cool, okay? I am not gonna throw any shade whatsoever to any of my competitors, no hate. I'm not gonna go after anyone's character or anyone's process. I'm just gonna look at it very objectively and really kind of help you formulate a strategy on how to approach each independent strategy from these different gurus, experts, and influencers, so you, the viewer, the audience, can make the very best decision for yourselves, not based off FOMO, not based off fear, not based off, you know, persuasion, but just you're coming equipped as a client, as a prospect, as a viewer. You're coming to the table very equipped. So that is my job here today, is to equip you. Not to really necessarily sell you, I am wanting you to get involved in these different concepts. Of course, that's the end game. That's why I make this channel. But nonetheless, I want you to really take more of how I'm operating, because my goal is to shift culture. Over the next 40 years, I plan to be doing this, creating content, forming alliances, creating strong bridges, strong relationships in areas that people would be like, how the heck did I ever go down? How the heck are they even friends, right? And that's my goal, really, is to become a synergist for the people in my space, in this industry, in the insurance business, to really not do what the majority do, right? You can see, if you do enough research, enough homework, my goodness, you're gonna see a lot of shade probably thrown at me, people going after my character, how I dress, how I look, how I talk. He talks slow. He doesn't know Jack. This kid is, you know, making videos out of his basement. I mean, a laundry list of attacks on the person, not the actual content. If you ever really pay close attention, they rarely go after this, the content. They go after the character. And so my role as you, if I was the viewer watching, other things that I can take away, other than the content, the concepts, and the financial ideas that I'm going to be sharing with you, I want you to also take away the approach, the characteristics of a king, of a queen, how we as kingdom citizens can operate in this very chaotic, divided world, and how right now there is a huge opportunity in 2021, especially in the insurance business, but also in any business for that matter. I think there's a huge opportunity for emerging leaders. So if you're watching, you want to become a leader, now is the best time to study leadership, to become a leader, to become a synergist, and to form alliances and relationships, because right now the trend is collaboration over competition. So you may get a lot of heat, you may get haters in your comments, in your DMs, attacking your character, not the content. Do not get offended. Do not be quick to get angry. Respond with love, with joy, with happiness. Invite them, praise them, because you can turn your greatest enemy into your greatest friend, okay? With that being said, let's dive into the content. Infinite banking process in 2021. What does it look like? Let's get going. Just like I do in almost every one of my videos, is I always start with the four major numbers. If I am not using someone else's numbers, a client's numbers, I will use my own numbers to illustrate a scenario, a particular concept, an idea, and that such. So in this video, we're going to be looking at my current numbers as of 2021. I am averaging roughly $25,000 a month in income. I have roughly five, almost six different streams of income at this point. I've been building a business now for roughly 3 years. Started in summer of 2018, this YouTube channel. We're now floating around 38, almost 39,000 subscribers. We're doing pretty good. Got a lovely kingdom. I got a wonderful financial ministry of helping moms. Okay, that is my goal. That is my mission, is to help moms restore their kingdom, raise a generation of young men and women to think differently, to change their culture, change their bad habits around money, and to influence them to do better righteous deeds, righteous good works in the marketplace and get paid at an exponential rate. Okay, so with that being said, my four major numbers, making roughly $25,000 a month. Expenses are roughly $10,000 a month. My debt is zero. I have zero bad debt, no liability. I have roughly $10,000 to $15,000, can be higher, in net cash flow per month. I have debt tools. I have access to debt, but I don't have debt. Okay. I personally do not consider a lease a debt. I have the ability to pay the entire lease up front if I so please. I choose not to, okay, because of opportunity costs and efficiency and other terms that I'll be throwing at you along the way. So I have access to debt in the form of lines of credit and credit cards, and also cash value life insurance, okay? I have capital assets, different investments, got crypto, gold, silver, HSA, Roth IRA, brokerage account. I'm very transparent with you. I want to share with you all my figures, all my numbers, so that you know what you're getting, right? I'm not going to give you any fluff. I'm not going to oversell the numbers. I'm not going to overestimate any of the numbers. Try to give you as accurate as humanly possible according to where I'm at currently. I am recording in October of 2021. This video will probably get posted in around November, okay? So with that being said, let's come back to the numbers here, right? So those are all my figures currently of what I'm operating with. Based on these numbers, based on the numbers that my clients give me, is how I develop an infinite banking process, a way to approach the concept of infinite banking so that I can actually establish a life insurance policy. So I have a couple of different components, okay? And we're gonna go one by one. And what I'll also do is I'll probably break this video up because it's gonna be very long. It's gonna be a very long video, but I'm gonna break up the video into smaller sections, little bites, so that you guys can watch it over time in other videos as well, if you're just looking for certain pieces to your puzzle. This video is gonna put it all together, but then I'm gonna break it up, give it to you in little bites, little pieces, so that you can really get laser focused on each section, okay? First section, know your numbers, your four major numbers. This has to be in line. This has to be healthy. We need discipline. We need structure. We need foundation. What is that for you? Is it Debt Snowball, Dave Ramsey, Susie Orman? Okay, great. Once you graduate from the seven baby steps, once you graduate from Susie Orman, Denzel, what does that mean? What does that mean to graduate? Graduate simply means you've done the work. You've got your emergency fund. You're saving. You're investing. You're tithing. You're giving. You're disciplined. You know your numbers. You don't overspend. You don't overleverage. You cash flow, positive cash flow. You have no debt, okay? That's what it means to graduate in that world. Dave Ramsey, Debt Snowball, Susie Orman, Debt Avalanche, Frugal, Minimalist. I get it. Once you graduate, now you're stepping into a ball game of leverage, of capitalization, of creating efficiency, creating arbitrage with your dollars. It is very likely that if you have the foundations down of money, that your ability to leverage and create cash flow, your ability to use debt to your advantage, instead of being a borrower, you are a lender, and you're also an effective borrower where you pay nothing in interest to create cash flow. Or if you do pay interest, the amount you get in return profit covers your interest, and you still have a net profit after taxes, after costs, after expenses. It's good stuff, okay? Going to another level. I talk to people here in the middle and further away from foundation, okay? So if you're here trying to get your foundation in line, go to the Velocity Banking pregame work I have a playlist. That's what it's called. And that'll help you along the way. Look, I'm Dave Ramsey certified as a financial coach. I believe in the foundations, but I also believe in graduating, where at some point we can incorporate credit cards. Why? Because we're disciplined. We can incorporate credit cards because we're gonna get cash back rewards on expenses, money that we're already spending each and every month. We can switch from monthly to annual to save roughly 10 to 20% on bills, right? We can borrow debt at zero cost, right? Where we create opportunities in the marketplace to get paid at an exponential rate via cash flow and profits. We start looking at tax strategies to lower our tax liability to increase profit. These are higher levels that do not get discussed in the foundations. Why? It's too high level. Not ready yet, right? This is why so many people try to jump away from the foundations, because they fall into the hype. And look, I'm probably, you know, one of those people that is gonna hype you up. I want you to get excited. There's a balance, right? You actually get on the phone with me and if I hear the language of poor mentality, broke mindset, I don't know how to make money, I can't make money, I'm not worthy, I'm not enough, I'm gonna push you further to the foundations. But now if I'm talking to somebody that's highly disciplined, hey, I've been saving for the past 15 years, I've been investing for the past 10 years, I have a business with my husband, with my wife, with my girlfriend, with my mom, with my dad, we've been building this business for the past 5 years, we're cash flow positive, we're looking to implement this infinite banking thing, we just came across it, we've got capital to start, we just want the best strategy and how to really incorporate this to our entire finances so that we can, you know, benefit on the estate planning and the taxes, and right? If you're there, you're with me. We're gonna have some fun, okay? Let's keep it going. Key component number one, foundations. If you're not there, go back in my other videos. Go back to the playlist to start the pregame work, all right? Let's say you got this down, the components of your four major numbers. Wonderful. The next component, I believe, is an ideal criteria on how to approach infinite banking no matter which way you go. And we'll go over the different options, okay? The ideal criteria that I personally guide my clients to or work their way up to is initial capital to start. How much money do you have right now to throw into a policy? Is it 50,000? Is it 500,000? Is it 5 million? Right? And we can go as high as you want, and we can go typically as low as a couple of $100 per month. And say we're doing like a baby policy, like literally a policy on a baby. Yeah, we could probably do like a couple $100 a month, no big deal. If I'm dealing with a 30, 40, 50 year old, paying in say $300 to $500 a month, I consider that a very baby policy, very, very small. There's not gonna be very much we can do with it. It does help with create discipline. But me personally, if you've only got $300, $400, $500 to start putting into a policy each and every month, I'm going to encourage you to actually try to 10x your income, take that cash flow, feed it into reading books, feed it into starting a business, feed it into starting some kind of side hustle, right? We're in the gig economy right now. Feed it into some type of income generating opportunity, not necessarily an asset that will benefit me long term. I'm not saying don't do it. I'm just saying I believe in timing, right? Timing. So if you're like $300, $400, $500 a month, you know, that's all you have. Yes, you can start a policy. Is it the right timing? Maybe not. Is it efficient? Maybe not. I think you can get so much more out of your $300, $400, $500 by reading books and by getting involved in some kind of income generating opportunity. Find opportunities in the marketplace, rank up at your job, get promoted, stack the cash up a little bit, build up the savings, build up an investment portfolio of some sort. Build before you start throwing your money at other assets, right? Let yourself be the best asset. Let's continue. So capital to start. The next thing is me preferably positive cash flow, $1,500 a month or more on a monthly basis. 1,500 times 12, that's 18 grand a year. Very solid amount of money to start a policy with, okay? But again, maybe that's not, if I'm only doing 1,500 a month in cash flow, times that by 12, that's 18,000. I don't think it's wise to take 100% of my cash flow and throw it into a policy, right? So let's evaluate that as well. Right? So considering, let's say you've got $1,500 a month in cash flow, but you have $30,000 saved up and you want to fund a policy $15,000 a year, I don't really have a problem with that because the first 2 years are covered based off your savings alone. And then in those 2 years, you're going to cash flow 18 grand times two, it's $36,000. You really never are going to run out of funding. And hopefully in those 2 years, you increase your income, you increase your cash flow, put you in a better economic position to keep funding the policy long term. So in a nutshell, starting ground, I say $1,500 or more per month, conservative, positive cash flow. The next thing is discipline, knowledge. Again, going back here, you know your numbers, your discipline. You got the foundations, great. Knowledge, you've studied this. You've looked at the options. You've looked at, you've evaluated, you talked to different agents. You've gotten different feedback. And now you're coming to a solid conclusion. You've got it down to maybe one or two agents that you want to work with. You're looking at different designs. And you're kind of like right at that point where you're like, okay, I'm ready to make that decision. So discipline, knowledge, that's the type of person I like to talk to, is somebody that did go to a different agent. I can tell you, like, majority of the business that I receive is from my competitors, especially the ones that throw hate at me, especially the ones that criticize me as a person, like my character, the way I have things set up, how I got started in the business. They're sending me so much business. It's amazing. I'm like, thank you. Thank you, hater. Thank you. Oh my God. Like I literally will have clients tell me, yeah, you know, the other guy, you know, has been in the business much longer than you, Denzel. And I feel like they really know the product, but the way you convey the message, the way you explain it, your commitment to your clients based on what I've seen on your channel, I just feel more comfortable. I feel like you're gonna take care of me long term. I like that you're young. I like that you plan on being in the industry for the next 40 plus years. I feel like I can send my kids to you, my mom, my dad, my sister, my cousin, my nephew, my uncle, I mean, everyone. I can't tell you how much business I get from the haters, from the competitors that throw shade in some little ways at me. I'm just like, yo, thank you. Do you want to collaborate, by the way? And they look at me with three heads, right? But hey, it's culture. Let's continue. The next thing is a set strategy. Why are we doing infinite banking in the first place? What is the purpose of your idea? And how does your idea align with the actual concept itself? Okay, so let's develop a set strategy, and we're going to go over some strategy options that are popular based off the concept itself, and also the marketers, the influencers, the gurus, the experts that have been doing this much longer than myself. Okay, the last key component of ideal criteria when I'm working with someone is a long-term mindset. Okay, you do have to realize that no matter which way you design a high cash value life insurance policy, it's going to be negative the first 3, 4, 5, 6, maybe 7 years or longer. It's going to be negative. Negative, what do you mean by that, Denzel? Negative just means like you put in 10 grand, you don't have 10 grand of cash value to start with year one. Year two, you do it again. You put in a total of 20, you have less than 20. Year three, you do it again. You put in, have a total of 30 grand, you have less than 30. It's not really until like the 4th, 5th, 6th, 7th year and onward is when the policy really starts to build, cook, and starts to grow and becomes a very, very effective tool long term. So you have to have a long-term mindset. Yes, we can have short-term gains based on what we do outside of the policy, but just focusing on the actual product itself, the policy itself, and the growth and performance of the policy itself, it's going to take some time. So you need that long-term mindset, or else you're probably just not going to be able to make sense of it. You're like, dude, it just takes too long. And if that's the case, dude, I totally understand. Let's go invest in crypto. Let's do Forex. Let's do options. Let's do futures. Let's do covered calls. Let's do real estate investing. Let's start a business. Let's 10x our income. I do believe, I'm with you. I agree with you. It's going to go much faster than this concept. Much faster. No argument. That's why you don't compare this to the investment. Why? Because part of the criteria, I didn't write it here, but part of the criteria is to understand that this is not an investment, although it may have been pitched that way. Maybe even I, Denzel Rodriguez, made a mistake in the past in one of my 500 plus videos that I've put out so far. Maybe even I use the word investment And that's something that I'm gonna fix myself, that I know I have fixed over the last like 2 years now. Being coached, being mentored, collaborating with other insurance agents, getting great feedback and insight on how I can improve and get better in my craft, right? So with that being said, long-term mindset, this is not an investment, right? Meaning you should not compare it to crypto. Don't compare it to a 401k. I would not compare it to a Roth IRA. I would not compare it to a brokerage account. Why? Because this is the and asset. Shout out to Caleb Gullums, who wrote a book called The And Asset. This is a asset on top of crypto, on top of your HSA, your Roth, your REIT, your 401k, your retirement plans, your brokerage account, your real estate. Let's say you have all of that and we have high cash value life insurance. Complete separate mentality. You got investment money. This is savings dollars. This is an alternative. Infinite banking concept is an alternative to where you save and store money, liquidity, and capital. Okay, very, very key. Let's continue. We've gone over two components so far. Groundwork, foundation, four major numbers, gotta know it. We went over ideal criteria. The very next thing, once you get your criteria down, and we're having a conversation, let's say it's you and I, you're a client of mine, or you're working with some of my affiliates or partners, other insurance agents in the business. The next thing that you need to be aware of before you even talk to an agent, so you kind of get an understanding of what to do, because it'll just equip you better, right? The whole point of this video is to equip you, is to understand the options in the infinite banking world. At this point, the infinite banking concept, those words are being used probably, and I'm probably a victim of this, is I've probably misused the concept. Probably misused the strategy. I've probably said it incorrectly. I'm more than likely, I've only been in the business 3 years. I know I've made mistakes. And you know, I've said this in multiple videos. Whenever I make a mistake, I own up to it. I get on camera, I say, hey, I made a mistake. This is no longer how I'm operating. That's what I said back then, but now I'm making an updated video. That's no longer how I operate. I think it is more efficient to operate this way. So maybe what I was doing wasn't necessarily wrong. It just wasn't efficient because I developed another strategy that made it more efficient than the previous one. So I'm the first to own up to my stuff and say, look, hey, that was Denzel in 2019. Now Denzel's got 2 more additional years of experience of growth, being a leader, made some mistakes. Let's keep it going. Let's have some fun. So let's look at the IBC options in terms of the marketing. Like, I have a belief about there's really only one way to incorporate the infinite banking concept. That's my belief, and that's based on the books that I've read and the other industry leaders, right? I think there's only one way to really implement infinite banking, but there are 3 types or 3 main strategies that get pitched when you're talking to the agent and they might use the words infinite banking. So IBC options, you've got a whole life insurance product, an index universal life insurance product, or a premium financing option using a whole life product or an index universal life insurance product. These are your 3 most popular options. And there are sub options within the whole life product, within the IUL, and within premium financing. But these are the 3 main ones that you should be aware of. So those are your options, okay? In a minute or two, I'm gonna share my screen and kind of open up the options, the marketing terms, terminology. You can take a screenshot, you can save it. I might even create like a little PDF that you can download and keep. This way, when you're talking to an agent, you kind of have the terms pulled up. And if they use a certain term, you say, oh, okay, he means that or she means that. And that'll really help you when you're talking to any insurance agent for that matter, whether they are experienced, inexperienced, or have no knowledge of infinite banking. So those are the 3 most popular IBC options. Next is I'm gonna come over here to this component, is policy design and your split options in regards to the type of product that you end up going with. You're either, when you're in this infinite banking space, you're either going to end up with a whole life product, some kind of an index universal life insurance product, or you're probably going to go premium financing, which is also a whole life product, or an index universal life. And in a nutshell, premium financing means that you are self-funding a policy. In addition, a bank is also paying your premium for a period of time. Okay, I'm not going to dive too into it. You can do your research, but that is very different, in my opinion, from the infinite banking process, the infinite banking concept. Very, very different. The industry leaders, Nelson Nash, Gary Gunderson, Matthew Pillmore, the Kwok brothers, Caleb, who I mentioned earlier, you got Kim Butler, you got all these, I mean, long, Bruce Wenner, you've got James Nethery, you got Carmen and Darius over at Wealth Nation. I mean, so there's really not a whole lot of people. That's why I'm like able to name these people off the top of my head. There's not a whole lot, by the way. Again, I'm going to show you the list in a minute. Most of them would agree that if we're just talking infinite banking concept, that means to take control over the banking process in your economy where you can scale it to infinity. You create an infinite banking system, machine, process that keeps going. You create a velocity of money. You're reusing dollars over and over again. You're recapturing costs. The most efficient way to do that, opinion based right here, and also based off the industry leaders, what they've said, their experience, best way to do that is with a whole life insurance product. The minute you step into premium financing, IUL, it's no longer infinite banking. It's a different strategy, which is nothing wrong with that. It's just, it's important on how we use our language so that you, the viewer, doesn't get confused. So you know, you don't think that they're one and the same. They're not. Infinite banking, it's its own thing. IUL, it's its own thing. Premium financing, it's its own thing. The reason why someone would go with an IUL or a premium financing is for the opportunity to create more income, more net worth. So we're not necessarily practicing any banking options. A premium financing product, your money is locked up. You really can't borrow from it for the first 5 years, maybe longer than that. That eliminates the banking process. With an IUL, it really doesn't make sense to borrow from the IUL in the beginning years of a policy if they're claiming that I can earn 15%, 11%, 25%, 35%, 50%. Why would I ever borrow money? Why would I take money from that if I can just keep the money all in there, working effectively in my favor, pay no interest, just keep feeding the beast? It's like an alternative investment type of a strategy mixed with some guarantees, because there are some non-guarantees and there's some added risk to it. And that's full transparency. Even the Index Universal Life Insurance agents will admit there's added risk, added cost. There's no getting around that. They totally agree with it. I just think it's no longer IBC. Call it something else, right? Give it a different name for it. Alternative to your 401k, alternative to your qualified retirement accounts. Don't call it infinite banking, because it's not, that's affecting what the actual concept and process is. So with that being said, we've gone over foundations, ideal criteria, IBC options. We're now over here on policy design and split. And here's where you get the varieties with the different insurance agents and organizations, people that are promoting the same concept that I'm promoting to you here today. So again, I think there is a range, and I think there should be a clear line as to when it's no longer considered infinite banking, because that's the topic here today. We're focused on that. So in regards to policy design, many different ways you can design a policy. You can design a policy for strictly death benefit, or you can design a policy strictly for cash value. Typically, when we're discussing infinite banking, we're designing the policy for high cash value, minimum death benefit. And then there's like a happy medium in between of high cash value and high death benefit. A best of both worlds, call it. So you can go far in one direction or far in the other. In regards to infinite banking, I believe it's right about here. The minute you cross that line, I think there's that's no longer infinite banking. Call it something else. So I think there's a range, and this is my opinion. I think there's a range. I think that the industry leaders, I'll show you their names in a minute and their channels and what they're doing. I think they would agree with me on this in terms of a range of infinite banking. And if you go out of that range, it's no longer infinite banking, call it something else. So my opinion, I think anything from a 10-90 split to a 40-60 split is the range for infinite banking, my personal opinion. If you are a influencer, expert, guru, you've been in this business longer than 3 years, you got a ton of experience, correct me. Give me your thoughts, comment below. I think this is the range, 10-90 to 40-60. What does that mean? That means if I am putting roughly, I'll use my numbers, right? I'm putting in $70,000 a year into one of my policies. I have two, one with MassMutual, one with Guardian. The one with Guardian, I'm paying in 70 grand a year. My base premium is 7,000. So that is a 10-90 split where 10% of 70 grand is premium. The other 90%, 63,000, goes into cash value with a PUA term blend with it. Anywhere in between that, all the way up to 40-60, right? Where you've got 40%, I'll do the math real quick. 70,000 times 40% is 28,000. So I could get the same exact amount of money, same age, same company, Guardian, and design a policy where I'm putting in 70 grand a year where my base premium is $28,000, okay? In my personal opinion, anything above 28,000, right? And maybe it goes a little bit higher, but like I'm talking like maybe like a 50-50 split, right? But really anything above 28,000, in my opinion, we are no longer really doing infinite banking because I'm locking up a lot of cash value in the early years. Now, granted, the policy will still perform long-term, no doubt. Policy will perform long-term. Problem is that liquidity feature, that access to cash, the efficiency, the banking process, that gets a little affected in the early years. That could cause the client to not be committed long-term to the product. Because why? It takes forever, right? So they may not be, you know, they may not enjoy that, right? So that's just, you know, my thoughts. And let me know your opinion below. So that is the most popular designs in the marketplace today. That's the other thing to be made aware of, is that you're likely gonna work with an agent that's gonna design a policy anywhere from a 10-90 split upwards of 40-60. If you go past that, I don't think you're no longer dealing with an infinite banking practitioner, infinite banking insurance agent that understands this process. Personal opinion. My current range, personally, I stick between 10-90 and 25-75. I really don't go higher than that, right? Personal preference. I use MassMutual and Guardian currently. Here are some popular companies that the industry leaders are currently using in this infinite banking space. Penn Mutual, Lafayette, Guardian, New York Life, Northwestern Mutual, Mass Mutual, Mutual Trust, Security Mutual Life, Mutual of Omaha. There's a couple of other ones, but I would say, based on my experience 3 years now in the industry, every client that has come to me from some other agent, they show me their policy illustration that they received. It was one of these companies: Security Mutual, Mutual Trust, Mutual of Omaha, Lafayette, Penn Mutual, Guardian, New York Life, Mass, Northwestern, right? Every time. I really have not gotten any other companies yet. So if there are other ones, go ahead and comment below. If you have a quote-unquote infinite banking policy designed for high cash value with a company that's not listed on here, comment below, let me know, right? And we'll add it to the list. So we've gone over policy design and split. The main component of a policy design is usually with the split when you're dealing with a whole life insurance product or even an IUL. Now you can still use the same formula, 10-90 to 40-60. In my opinion, with IULs, you want to be as far away from 40-60 as possible with an IUL because of the insurance costs and expense, I think is a little cheaper compared to a whole life. I might be incorrect on that. Someone can comment below and give me some feedback. But some of every single IUL agent I've spoken to that is designing IULs for high cash value, long-term growth, income, tax-free income distribution, they're more closer to 1090 in terms of the premium, the base premium, and that term expense and that such. So policy design, not going to dive too deep into. I'm just letting you know it's a component that you want to be aware of, and then you can discuss with the agent how do you design policies typically. You can ask them, what is your range, right? And you can start by understanding who the industry leaders are and then how people branched off from that to do different things, right? So the industry leader is Nelson Nash. And I've spoken to agents that actually talked to Nelson Nash, maybe worked with him, maybe collaborate with him. And his initial point was you start off with a 30-70 is where you start. Typically, you might end up at a 33-67 or as high as 40-60. That's the range of the Nelson Nash Institute, I believe, becoming your own banker, right? That's based on the agents that I've spoken to, like I said, that have been with Nelson Nash, worked with him, designed policies with him, went through the IBC practitioner program to become certified. That's the most popular design. Is anywhere between a 30-70 to 40-60 is the most popular policy designs to date, where you've got 30 to 40% of your capital going to base premium, the rest going to PUA, or AKA cash value, that you can use to exercise the banking function, right? The banking process to become your own banker. So foundation, policy design, ideal criteria, popular companies, IBC options, last but not least, and quite frankly, very important, which will affect how you design your policy, is the strategy behind why you're obtaining the policy. Everybody's going to have a different reason because everybody's at different financial stages. The most popular strategy options that I have personally seen working with clients, talking to insurance agents. Number one, first and foremost, is probably the most important, one of the most important features of IBC, specifically tax-free savings. Alternative to where I'm saving my money at the bank currently earning nothing. So this is an alternative high yield tax-free savings account, life insurance. So no matter what your other strategy is, this is probably the foundation of all the other strategies. The next that I think is also kind of rooted with the design itself is a tax-free death benefit. When you die, a big lump sum tax-free death benefit gets paid out to your heirs. No matter what, that's there, right? Next is tax-free leverage, the ability to borrow against your policy, to create arbitrage, to create cash flow, to invest, to build a business, to be a lender, right, of some sort. I practiced this. I invested in a company, gave them 10 grand, and we negotiated a 10% rate of return on my money, right? Actually, I think it's 20. I might be lying to you. It's anywhere between 10 and 20% of what I lent to this small company. I borrowed from my policy at 5%. I'm gonna make 10 to 20% on my money, create arbitrage. My cost of borrowing in the policy was nothing. I get a profit, I get the principal back, I pay back the policy, I have profit, I rinse and repeat. So leverage. Here's where it gets a little controversial, is these three other strategies that get a little controversy. People, some industry leaders like it, don't like it, okay? The first is tax-free income / distribution, very similar to liquidating a 401k or any type of qualified retirement plan. I do not personally agree with it. I do not see the value personally in liquidating my bank for income. The intent at the end of the day is to have a humongous tax-free death benefit paid out. I don't want to necessarily withdraw or take all of the cash value that I built up over this long period of time that I've been funding with my dollars. I don't want to just, you know, sit on the couch, put my feet up, and then kind of coast where I liquidate my entire bank. And then you're either doing that via withdrawals or policy loans, maybe a bit of both. If and when I do that, eventually, especially with people living very, very long, if you live all the way to 100, eventually a lot of that money may run out. You're probably gonna run out of cash value or get to a point where you have tremendously affected the death benefit. Because no matter what, when you die, however much you had in loans plus interest gets minused from the death benefit, and then your heirs get the net death benefit. Hey, some people do it. I personally just don't agree with it. I feel like I can personally get more value by building my bank, establishing it, my private infinite banking system, where I borrow against the policy. I borrow against it, create arbitrage profits. I invest in other cash flowing assets that will create cash flow. So regardless of the net worth accumulated of that asset, it'll continue to produce cash flow. So therefore, I never have to pull money or income from my bank. I keep the bank in motion. And then when I die, covers my whole estate tax, covers death benefit, death funeral costs, covers any liabilities or debts, covers any investments or ventures that my kids, my future family wants to get into, right? So that's a personal opinion, but it's quite popular. Tax-free income distribution. You get to decide how you want to do that. The next one that is pretty controversial, that also I agree to an extent, right? Which is financing your living costs or tools, such as equipment financing, cars, boats, houses, whichever. I agree to roughly 50% on the tool side. Like if we're gonna borrow against the policy to fund a real estate transaction, crypto, forex, options, futures, covered calls, to create arbitrage, I'm all for it, right? I actually should put that over here. I should say that is more so here. So I'm gonna take that back. That's here. In the invest, the 10X, and the lending, I'm 100% in agreement with that. More so tools, say a car, very high cost equipments in your business or house, you're doing house repairs. How much am I really gaining by buying a car through the policy? Like what am I really gaining from that, right? So what is the gain? And compare it. Could I have done better? Just ask yourself that. So that's where I don't necessarily agree with that. I don't see the true value in it. Now, when it comes to financing your living, I am personally doing this, but only for a period of time, not forever. Because if you try to do it forever, it is eventually going to become inefficient, right? It's just not gonna be all that valuable because of the way the loans and the interest compounds in the policy itself. It's not gonna be all that great long term. But in the short term, hell yeah. And I've been able to prove it personally in my own numbers, where I have roughly, I'm looking at my other board right now, I've got $21,390 and a penny of expenses, both personal and business, where I am saving on average a little over 12% on my expenses alone. So I am netting roughly like $3,000 in savings, but in reality, the actual product and cost is a little bit higher. So it's almost like double, like $6,000+, almost $10,000 that I'm saving by not paying cash, by running it through the policy, which is gonna earn money forever, compounded, borrow against it at a loan interest rate. But then before I use this cash to pay the bill, I'm actually using a credit card where I switch from monthly to annual, save 10 to 20% on the bill itself, then get 3% cash back. So that 3%, 4, 2%, that right there, I'm getting roughly $2,600 or maybe more than that just in cash back for running those bills. So I'm saving thousands, but then I'm receiving a couple thousand dollars per year through the credit cards. That to me, highly effective for maybe a good 5 to 7 years, probably nothing more than that, because eventually you want to start paying back the loan. 20,000 times 7, 140,000 in loans. Eventually that loan interest is going to start catching up to my 10 to 20% in savings, not earnings, but savings. So that's where you can see how we can run into an issue. And this is me making a tweak, making an improvement on my infinite banking process, because I would tell my clients, yeah, you know, we can run expenses through the policy and blah, 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 and I would running the math. But in the back of my head, I was telling the clients, like, you know, this is good short term, just not long term. But I never really explained why until I really ran it all the way through. So I ran all the numbers in my situation personally, ran it all the way through for 7 years straight, tried to go longer with it, and saw it becoming inefficient, where in reality, the net savings was getting lower and lower. It wasn't 10, 20%. It was like getting down to 8, 7, and 6, which is very close to my loan interest rate of 5 or 6%. That's of 2021. Going into 2022, the loan interest rates are dropping on life insurance policies, but so is the guarantees of these policies. So when I saw that, I was like, you know what? I'm probably better off cutting that off at some point within 7 years or less. And then instead of that 20 grand, I'm just gonna now keep running that 20 plus thousand of bills through my personal and business credit cards, use my cash, my income, pay that off. But then the money, the 70 grand that's going into my policy, now I've got 20 plus thousand dollars that I'm gonna use for investing. Crypto, gold, silver, HSA, my Roth, my brokerage account, stock market, dividends, index funds, real estate, you name it, on and on and on. And I'm gonna net a higher profit, 20% returns, 30, 40, 50, 100% returns, you know, by just keeping the compounding effect going, the rule of 72. So powerful stuff. Tax-free income distribution, I don't necessarily agree with it. Financing and living tools, I'm roughly 50% in agreement. I'm 100% here, 100% here, 100 there, 100 there. These are the most popular strategies. You know, the last one, what I was saying earlier about investing, 10xing your income, becoming a lender, creating arbitrage. I don't see how you can possibly go wrong, which is why I also don't see why you would take income or distribution if you could just keep borrowing from the policy to keep investing and keep 10xing your income. I don't see why you would stop that to just take a distribution and income. You know, I just don't see the value. Maybe because I'm 25 and maybe I'll think differently when I'm 70, 80, 90 years old. Maybe, maybe not. Again, it could just be a cultural misunderstanding that a king really, and a queen, I would say, in my opinion, a king and a queen are in their roles for life. They can transfer the crown to the heir, but the heir, the son or daughter, only becomes king when the king dies. The princess only becomes a queen when the queen dies. And now son and daughter take over mom and dad's empire, kingdom, the business, whichever you want to call it. I use the term kingdom. That's just my personal preference. That's what sets me apart in the marketplace. But with that being said, what I'd like to do now, we went over the main components. What I'd like to do now is share my screen, infinite banking terms, so that you don't get confused when an insurance agent uses a particular terminology to explain or pitch infinite banking. You need to know the difference so that you don't think one is different from the other. Marketing terms are marketing terms. It's what makes that guru, expert, consultant, influencer, you know, big in the space, right? That's what gets them to the top of the list. But it still comes down to just a few product options. So the infinite banking terms, let's go through it. The most popular one out there, right? Infinite banking concept, become your own banker, bank on yourself, private banking, tax-free banking, cash flow banking, dynamic banking, your own family bank, sacred account, master account. These are all marketing terms. They all mean the same thing, whole life, or they might be using index universal life. They might be using an L100 product, an L95, a 10-pay, 20-pay, 30-pay, etc. Those are sub-designs, but it's still under a whole life insurance contract. They might even say, I forgot this one, investment grade insurance contract, which definitely turned a lot of heads, especially the industry leaders, got very offended. I would say there's some very outspoken industry leaders that get offended because they're using the word investment, which is incorrect, because life insurance by definition is not an investment, or else you and I would be taxed. And the whole idea is for it to not be taxable, right? To have tax-free leverage, tax-free potential income distribution if you went that route, and then tax-free death benefit, right? So investment grade insurance contract is, it hurts the infinite banking's industry leaders. It hurts the whole industry as a whole, as insurance agents. It hurts us all as a whole, because now the client is now going to compare a real investment like real estate, like crypto, like the stock market, like stocks and futures and covered calls and Forex. They're gonna compare it and they're gonna say, dude, I'm only getting less than 4% guaranteed internal rate of return when I can earn 10, 20, 30, 40, 50, 100% by investing in the marketplace, right? And I would say, hey, I agree with you. I agree with you. You're absolutely correct. The problem is that's not an investment. So therefore we probably shouldn't be comparing an investment with a savings strategy, two separate components that build your financial portfolio, both protection, investment, risk, hedge, inflation, all that. The actual product, okay, from those marketing terms, they're going to give you a whole life insurance contract, index universal life. Same thing with the premium financing. It's going to be a whole life insurance contract or an index universal life insurance contract. It might be variable, it might be fixed, might be a little bit of both, okay? Next thing is the infinite banking players. This is my personal research that I've done. I'm pretty sure there are others on here, but what I did was I went off of YouTube, because you're watching this probably on YouTube or Facebook, right? I might post this video on Facebook, but primarily this video is on YouTube. I am a YouTuber. So I looked at all the YouTubers, content creators. There are some podcasts. Those are the two main platforms I believe where you will find infinite banking. It's either YouTube, podcasts, or blog posts, blog websites. But for the most part, YouTube. Why is that? It's pretty hard to explain this concept via a podcast, in my personal opinion. Pretty hard to do. Some people do it and they're pretty effective with it. Other than that, I think you need PowerPoints, a whiteboard, illustrations. You need to show something, because this is an intangible product. It's something that you'll get on a paper, and it's a contract, right? You get an online portal. So it's an intangible product, which is why I think you need a method of teaching, changing it up in terms of how you teach it. So like I said, these are the main players. You can take a screenshot. Most of these people I know or have I've actually spoken to. Some I've commented on their channels and give them some praise and glory, and I'm doing it again right now, right? And I went in order of highest subscribers, right? To be totally transparent, not really give any favoritism to any in any particular way. So I just went off of subscriber base. I felt like that was the best way. So it doesn't mean that Kim Butler at the bottom is the worst one, nor does it mean that Stephen Gardner is the best one. I just went off of subscriber base. So that's how I made the list, to be very, very, you know, unbiased, right? So starting at the top is Stephen Gardner. He is the largest YouTube channel subscriber-wise that is familiar with the infinite banking concept, practices it himself, and I believe designs policies. Stephen Gardner he's an author. He's written a couple of books. I've spoken to him. We've collaborated multiple times together. I think he is a straight up guy. His channel today more so is focusing, I think, in the political realm, stimulus checks, updates, government updates. Not really putting a whole lot of content right now on infinite banking. But if you were to scroll back into his earlier days, you're going to see a good amount of content on infinite banking. So nonetheless, that's Stephen Gardner. Chris Krohn is same thing. He got 728,000 subscribers as I'm recording this video in October of 2021. He talks about whole life and IUL. He had an insurance agent that does IUL, but he personally prefers whole life. He has whole life policies. That's what he prefers. But his main channel is about real estate investing. I think that's where he makes a bulk of his wealth, is in real estate investing and then being a content creator and all that stuff. I think he's a solid dude as well. Never spoken to him personally, but I've commented on his channel and I've watched his material. He's pretty out there. He's pretty, you know, he's well known, right? He's like a softer Grant. You know, he's hardcore, but he doesn't push me as much as like a Grant Cardone would push me in terms of like either motivation or getting me to do something, or, you know, the 10X mindset in that sense. VIP Financial, never spoke to the guy, Matthew Pillmore, who runs the channel, 238,000 subscribers. Never spoke to him, but I've commented on his channel. I gave his channel a review. I think he's an awesome dude, solid guy. And same thing, I think he's mentioned IULs before, but I think he's more of a whole life. And he's worked with I've seen a couple of different insurance agents that he's worked with. So I don't know if he works with multiple different agencies, but it looks like he's done business with quite a few. The next is the Kwok Brothers, 196,000 subscribers. I think they're more so in the whole life. Seven Figure Squad, 134,000 subscribers. That Matt Sapala, he is partners with Patrick Bet-David with Valuetainment. And he's in an insurance industry, which is a network marketing company called PHP, People Helping People. And so they typically push IULs over whole life as a, again, income distribution alternative income stream, which I don't necessarily agree with, but to each his own, right? So that's another way, the IUL, seven figure. He also works with the guy below, Doug Andrew, who's got 39,000 subscribers, and he focuses on IUL. He's very anti-whole life from the material that I've watched, and he strictly does IULs. Same with Seven Figure Squad, Matt Sapala. I think he's very more so IUL, but might do a couple whole life policies. Not sure. Next is Wealth Nation, 100,000. Shout out to Carmen and Darius to hitting 100,000 subscribers. I'm on my way there. I'll meet you there soon. Wealth Nation is great. I've collaborated with them a couple different times, once on my channel, once on theirs. We have a viral video together on their channel, roughly over 250,000 views. Great conversation we had. They're a wonderful couple. They've, I think they recently had a baby not too long ago. So they're a growing family. They're more into whole life and they stick in the 40-60 realm of designs. I think they might go a little lower, but I think they typically push 40-60 in terms of how they design a policy. Same with, I think a Steven, I think, and Chris might be VIP. Again, like I said, those designs are more popular, the 30-70 and the 40-60, very, very popular. Next is Garrett Gunderson, love this guy. His main focus, really, from what I get, he's more in like the holistic financial approach and also very, very immersed in the tax game, you know, saving money on taxes, working with business owners. So he's definitely dealing with a higher caliber of clientele. Okay, so he's at 63,000 subs right now and he's rocking and rolling. He's combining comedy and finances. Dude's going on a comedy tour, so shout out to him. I think he's doing some great work. He is very pro whole life, very anti IUL. Okay, so you're definitely gonna get that passion. He's gonna be like, dude, these things fail. IULs, 90% of them fail. He's very against them, strictly whole life. Cool. Doug Andrew, strictly IUL, very anti whole life. You got your boy Denzel Rodriguez, personal finance geek, 21st century. We're rocking and rolling at 38,000 subscribers on YouTube. And we also have a presence on Instagram, Facebook, LinkedIn, Clubhouse. We're doing all right. Very, very, very small presence on TikTok-y, right? I'm building some videos over there, but not too concerned right now. YouTube is my jam. Denzel is primarily focused on whole life. I'm not anti-IUL. I don't know enough to say that I'm anti-IUL. I personally do not own an IUL policy. I do not practice premium financing. I'm in the learning phase, 25 years old. I'm one of the youngest guys on this list, okay? So your boy Denz, your cousin D, he's learning. he's building, creating transparency. My goal is to talk to every single one of these people on the list and do some kind of collaboration at some point in time, okay? And yes, some of these people on this list have thrown shade my way, but it's okay. It's okay. It's gonna be okay, you know? Next is IBC Global Steve Parisi. That is my business partner, friend, coach. That's the guy who pretty much taught me a lot, almost everything on the infinite banking. Super transparent. He shows all the options. 1090, 2080, 37, 3070, 4060, 2575. I mean, the guy just shows it all. And he's like, make a decision. So I like that approach. Very transparent. Shows it all. How the insurance agents get paid, commissions, how commissions affect policy performance. I mean, how to create a mech, how to avoid a mech. Super transparent. You just don't see that on many of the other channels. You just don't. A lot of the times, infinite banking is just a long-winded conversation. Not a whole lot of data being shown. It's just a lot of conversations, which is great. I believe in conversating. But I'm a guy that really likes numbers. Show me, break it down into key components so that we can make a decision. So IBC Global is great. The Money Advantage. Rachel, Bruce Wenner, if I'm saying his name right. Rodney Morgan. I've seen them collaborate together. Good stuff. They're very, very pro whole life, anti IUL. They don't do it. Curtis Ray, new kid on the block is what I've heard, right? I thought I was the new kid on the block, but he's really the new man on the block because he's much older than me. So Curtis Ray, I don't think he's that much older, but I think he's got a couple years on me. Curtis Ray sitting at 10,000 subscribers. Very, very, very anti whole life. Very pro IUL. He's even gone to the extent to say that infinite banking is a scam, which is very interesting because it's kind of like, you know, he's stealing from infinite banking when he says that, because it's like, well, wait a minute, isn't IUL supposed to kind of mimic or overperform over infinite banking? So can be a little of a conflict of interest there. So, but you'll see if you watch his material like I have. Very, very anti whole life. Like I said, he's gone to the extent of saying infinite banking is a scam, right? He said that, and he's got a whole video on it where his reasons why. So you can check that out. And he's very pro IUL, yet his strategy has to do with building an IUL policy and then borrowing from the policy like you would in the infinite banking world. So get what I'm saying? He's stealing that process, calling it his own. And then he's feeding the loan back into the policy to build it up, which is kind of weird because if IULs do what they actually say they're gonna do, 10%, 25%, 30%, 50% return, whatever number is above whole life returns, why on earth would I ever borrow from it if I can just keep earning a higher rate and not pay any loan interest? Doesn't make sense to me, but that's, again, look. Research, do the work, right? Don't just rely on Denzel or Garrett or Carmen and Darius, you know, or Steven or Chris or Matthew. Look at everyone, evaluate it, form your own criteria, and then you pick the person that you feel is in alignment with how you operate as a person financially and what your goals are. And if they can convey the message effectively to you, then that's probably the person you want to go with. Right? So Curtis Ray, IUL, Nelson Nash, he passed away, but his legacy still continues. So the Nelson Nash Institute, 9,000 subscribers, very pro whole life, anti IUL. Oregon Cashflow Pro, one of the few that does whole life and IUL. He sees the value in both, right? So his Oregon Cashflow Pro, James Barber, is the host of that channel, creates the content, gives very good feedback on whole life products and IUL. Solid dude. Next is James Nethery, who is an infinite banking practitioner, worked directly with Nelson Nash before passing. So he's in that realm. He's at 7,000 subscribers, also has a podcast. Banking Truths, never met him, never spoke to him, 4,000. Caleb, Banking Truths, I don't know his name, but I'm pretty sure he's pro whole life. Does mostly whole life products. Caleb Gullums, if I'm saying his last name right, Better Wealth, roughly 3,000, a little over 3,000 subscribers. And he's actually the same age as me. I met him at FinCon this year, FinCon 2021. We're going to do a future collaboration together. He wrote the book called The And Asset, which I read. My biggest takeaway from that book was efficiency, creating efficiency. Okay, solid guy. Next is Jerry Fetta, 1,000 subscribers on his YouTube channel. He's not really much of a content creator. This guy's a business builder, you know. So he, you know, don't be fooled by the subscriber count. Okay, don't be fooled. Again, Stephen Gardner is not necessarily the best one on the list just because he has at the top, right? Even though he has 1 million subscribers, like that's why I wanted to make this as purely transparent as possible. But like a guy like Jerry Fetta, this guy's worth multiple millions of dollars, yet he's at the bottom of the list. But that's only because of his subscriber base, not his work ethic, not his business background, not his experience in the game. But Jerry Fetta is awesome. He's got a whole tax business, investing business, real estate business. He's got multiple businesses where he works with clients, putting these policies in place. Solid guy. He's over in Alaska. I spoke to him multiple times. His wife is awesome. They, him and his wife work together. They're a power couple, powerhouse. And then last is Kim Butler, sitting at 800 subscribers, maybe more than that by the time this video gets posted. Again, this lady's been in the industry longer than probably most of the people on this list. Definitely longer than me, right? Again, I've only been in it 3 years. Very knowledgeable. I've never met her, never spoke to her, right? Heard about her through Caleb, watched a video, 40 minute or so long video, and I learned some things from Kim, right? So, which is solid, 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 solid stuff. And then to finish it off, we got Infinite Banking books that you ought to read that I think will benefit you and will craft your philosophy on this concept. You've got Become Your Own Banker and Building Your Warehouse of Wealth by Nelson Nash. You got The And Asset by Caleb. Money, Wealth, Life Insurance by Jake Thompson. You got The Case for IBC. I think that was also written by Nelson Nash. What Would the Rockefellers Do and Killing Sacred Cows is written by Garrett Gunderson. And then Live Your Life Insurance, written by Kim Butler. So these are all books that I've done research on that I think are highly effective and will help craft your philosophy around infinite banking. Now what I want to do in this part of the video, this has been long, very effective, but we're going to keep going. I want to share with you some infinite banking improvements that your very own finance geek, Denzel Rodriguez, has made to improve my language on how I deliver the concept effectively to you, right? The messaging. And also strategies that I have improved based on what I've said in the past. So first thing, and shout out to Kim Butler and Bruce for telling me this, is when you are borrowing inside of a life insurance policy, whole life or IUL, the proper way to say it is we're borrowing against the policy. We're not borrowing from the policy. Why? Because if I was borrowing from the policy, it's kind of like me taking a loan from my 401k. So if I have $100,000 in my 401k and I take out a loan from the 401k for $30,000, I now have $70,000 inside of the 401k and I have $30,000 outside of the 401k, which I'm going to go do some work with. Try to create some arbitrage. I'm going to pay an interest back to myself. With a cash value life insurance policy, we're borrowing against the life insurance policy, meaning similar to a home equity line of credit. When you borrow against the equity in your property, the bank is giving you money and they're putting your equity as collateral. Insurance company, I borrow against the life insurance policy, the cash value. The insurance company, let's say I got $100,000 in cash value, I take out a loan for $30,000. At whatever interest rate, 5%, maybe 6% or lower, you are going to get the insurance company's money. They're gonna give you their money at their interest rate, and your cash value is now collateral. So what happens is your cash value is gonna continue to grow uninterrupted. It's gonna keep growing compounded as if you never touched the money in the first place. Similar to a home equity line of credit. No matter how much I borrow from my HELOC, right, the amount of money that my property appreciates has no effect to the amount of debt that is on the property. So when I borrow against the HELOC, take money out to do velocity banking, to pay off some other debts, to consolidate some debts, your property will continue to appreciate in value. That has no effect to the value of the property, okay? So that's one fix, IBC improvements, okay? The second thing, I did a video titled This Exact Thing, Infinite Banking Process in 2020. In that video, you'll hear me say, and I've said in other videos, you'll hear me say how I am running taxes through the life insurance policy, right? And how I was gonna do that year to year. I am no longer doing that. Why? It's no longer efficient compared to the investment strategies and the 10X strategies that I have going on in the policy itself. Where did I get the idea of running taxes through the policy? Through the famous book, Become Your Own Banker by Nelson Nash. There's a strategy about equipment financing and taxes. So I think it has some efficiency to a degree. Long-term, no. In my opinion, I think we can do a hell of a lot better by borrowing against the policy at whatever interest rate and then investing that money and earning a much higher rate of return, bigger gains, bigger profits, use the principal to pay back the policy loan plus the interest to cover the loan interest, and you're left with a net profit outside of the policy. And you might even be producing cash flow as well from that asset or dividends to some extent. So I've improved on that. The next thing is I'm no longer gonna say 90-10, 80-20, 70-30, 60-40, because that's creating a little confusion. Because everybody, and I mean everybody, says 10-90, 20-80, 30-70, 60-40, 25-75, 15-85. Now, I don't know about you, but it sounded easier to just say 90-10, 70-20, 60-40. It's like I have to think to say 10-90, 20-80, 70-30, 60. I gotta get used to saying it. But for the longest, I've been saying 90-10, 80-20, 70-30, 60-40, 75-25. Why? When you say that to the infinite banking industry leaders and experts, they're thinking, oh shit, Denzel is doing 90-10 split policies. That's 90% base premium, 10% cash value. That's terrible. Don't do that. Terrible. Don't do that. Now, I'm not doing it because I explain in the videos 90% is cash value, 10% base premium, or 20% base premium, 80% cash value. So small tweak in the language. I'm now going to say 10-90 because we're saying that first number is base premium. And the second number is cash value, okay? The next thing is interest. How we deal with loan interest when we're borrowing against, not from, against. When we're borrowing against our policies, do you pay back the loan immediately over time? How do you handle the loan interest? Comment below. I personally was guiding my clients with two different options. I was saying, when you borrow money against the policy, we want to earn a higher rate of return out here, and we want to strategically pay back the loan over time, the principal. The loan interest, I would rather you pay the loan interest with your own money, additional cash flow, or the profit, the savings, the recapturing of cash flow from whatever it is we use the money when we borrowed against it. Does that make sense? Those two options. So let's show an example so that you are clear. Let's say 100,000 cash value. You and I, we take out a $40,000 loan, 5%, okay? That 5% is simple interest compounded. So in 1 year, you're gonna pay $2,000 in interest if you keep the loan outstanding for an entire 12 months. Got it? So what happens is you can either, from your four major numbers, right? Let's use mine. I can take my cash flow in 1 month, $2,000, and immediately pay the loan interest from the policy, right? I can immediately pay the loan interest, and now I've got $40,000, which the goal is to earn higher than 5%. So maybe I earn 10, 12%, 9%, whatever it is. So I'm gonna earn, let's say I earn 10% on 40 grand over 12 months, that's $4,000 that you and I will earn together, okay? I can use 2,000 from the four to pay the loan interest, or I use my cash flow, my additional cash flow from my income to pay the loan interest. I personally was telling my clients one of the two, to do one of the two. And worst case scenario, you let the policy performance or you let the policy cash value pay the loan interest. In my opinion, this is me improving. In my opinion, that's the worst way. I didn't necessarily think it was as bad in the beginning, but as I learned and got better, I said, no, that's actually not efficient long-term. Maybe in the beginning, maybe in a crisis, but that does have an effect on the performance of your cash value if you're taking from your cash value to pay the premium or pay the loan interest. I personally do not want to do that, right? So I'm getting further away from that and I'm sticking to those other two options. Either the profit from earnings on 40K pays the loan interest, or I use cash flow to pay the loan interest. In my opinion, I prefer to use cash flow. I think is the best way. Use my additional income and revenues, pay the loan interest myself out of pocket, and profit the whole 10% in whatever investment that is. So now I got 44K in the investment, and that's gonna compound at 10% the following year. And I'm still hardcore on this, I do not pay back the policy loan principal because that has no effect to the cash value. The interest does. And that was the differentiation that I had to learn. So I think I got better on that. Let me know your thoughts. To the experts that are watching, the people that have been in this industry for a while, how do you like that? So me personally, I have a policy, right? And let me go ahead and share my screen so I can share with you exactly my policy figures and numbers and all that good stuff. So let's come over here. This is Denzel's policy, okay? So as you can see, we are now in year two, approaching year three. Current cash value, 33,000. Got a loan out for 13.5. I'm funding 15K a year, base premium 1500. The LISR, that's like the term 1500, and the ALER, that's pure cash value 12K. That's the splitting of the money where the 15K is going. Okay, death benefit almost at a mil, just under 900K. I'm gonna be paying 15K in for the next like 31 years, all the way up until age 65. After age 65, becomes a reduced paid up. Okay, the strategy for me in this policy is just to simply fund it all the way up until I can't fund it no more, right? It's a very, very long-term funding policy, and I'm gonna be borrowing from the policy to make investments, to create cash flow. I'm never going to do an income distribution strategy from this policy. I don't see the value in doing that. I think it would hurt my policy long-term, along with the death benefit. So I'm not gonna do that. Guardian, same thing. Go back up to the top. I'm in my third year. Funding 70,000 a year, base premium 7K. It's literally only designed to fund for about 7 years. After that becomes a reduced paid up. If I don't do that, I can keep funding the policy, but not at 70K. That is the disadvantage of a 1090 split, is that you cannot fund it as long as you typically would like. It gets a little iffy according to like the risk, in my opinion. I still gotta learn. But that's when the argument for having a higher base premium would essentially make a little more sense if you wanna go really, really long. Now, with MassMutual, they let you go as low as 1090 and fund pretty long. So that's pretty interesting too with the insurance limitations. But still in this, my term insurance expense is going to get extremely expensive in these years, the 50s, 60s, 70s, and 80s, which is why if I continue to keep going in the late 60s, 70s, and 80s, I might have an issue if I didn't overinflate my MEC to support that. So again, the policy is set up to design up to 65, funding up to age 65. If I go longer, I might run into an issue. That term cost is gonna become very expensive, which is why I just do a reduced paid up. Or worst case scenario, I just pay the base premium after 65. If I still wanna keep paying into it, I just pay the base premium. Okay. So I just want to, you know, share that. Guardian, same thing. 70 grand. I currently have, does it say it here? Doesn't show what I have in loans. Oh no, it's right here. This, yeah, I've got 76,000 in loans at the moment. Money outstanding. Each and every year, I pay the loan interest out of pocket. And then I create more profit from it. So I just want to show you those two policies so you get a nice idea of that. Let's come back to the board. All right. So when I, each and every year, I'm taking out 40K. I'm paying somewhere in the neighborhood between 5% and 6% for Guardian. And then whatever is the interest rate, I pay it in full upfront in the beginning from my cash flow. So in addition to putting in 70 grand, I'm also paying an additional couple thousand dollars in interest. That 40 grand is now gonna go to work for me, right? I'm doing a mixture of crypto investing, gold, silver, max funding an HSA, the Roth, well, not a Roth anymore because I make too much dang money. And I'm looking at the backdoor Roth strategy. So I got that in my hindsight. But in the meantime, I just have a brokerage account. So I got the stock, HSA, gold, silver, crypto. I'm doing some lending. Like I said earlier, I lent some money, real estate, right? All of these things are going to yield much higher returns than 5% to 6%. We're talking 100% returns over a long period of time, depending on what I invest in. Like a crypto investment, I could get 100x, not 100x, 100%. Well, probably in reality, when I bought Ethereum around $300, now it's at 3,000 plus. That's a, is that a 300% return or higher? I forget. Let me see. I forget the name. But these are high returns. Yes. So those returns, I don't want to affect the compounding, the rule of 72 on those investments. So I'm going to keep creating revenue and income and just pay the loan interest myself, and I'm financing these things. Meanwhile, the same money is growing in the policy, uninterrupted interest compounded tax-free. So it creates a wash effect, no cost of borrowing. Highly effective, in my opinion. This is the infinite banking process in 2021. I personally, on the list, I have a very strong relationship with Steve Parisi, who writes predominantly whole life policies designed for minimum premium, maximum cash value. The range, we typically float around 1090 to 2575 split designs. Typically won't go higher than that, right? If we go higher, it's only because the client requested it, and hey, totally fine. The companies that we typically work with, MassMutual and Guardian, but we're super transparent. They will provide illustrations for other companies if you want to look and make your comparison, make a decision from there. Well, that's how we like to just kind of just show the options. Okay, here's how it goes, right? Make a decision from there. If you wanted to work directly with myself, I am personally a financial consultant and a financial coach first. That's my main role. I'm a strategist. So I like to sit down. I like to do consultations. Usually I catch most of you before you're even ready for infinite banking. If you're ready for infinite banking and you don't feel like you need coaching or a consultation or anything like that, you go right to IBC Global, you click the link below, ready to start your life insurance asset, your life insurance policy, bam. You go right to there and they will help you. You can talk to Samantha, Stephanie, Phil, Brandon, Steve Parisi himself. I think he's not really writing too many policies at this point. He's got an entire team, so he's running the operation. But Phil is amazing, Samantha, Stephanie, Brandon. These are great insurance agents that are on the team. So they're going to be better at designing policies than me. I will say personally, I've never designed a policy by myself alone. I've always had help, which is why I like to let you guys know that I'm first a financial consultant and coach. All right, so I bring the strategy where I'll ask you questions like, okay, you want to do infinite banking? Husband and wife. Okay, we're going to start on wife. Okay, cool. Here's a question for you, husband and wife. How long have you been saving money? Like, what do you mean? How long have you been saving money? I'm not really concerned about the amount of money. I want to know, how many years have you consecutively, consistently saved money? I've done it for about 13 years. Okay, great. How long have you been married? 15 years. Awesome. Ever got a divorce? Ever been separated? No, Denzel. Solid 15 years. Never had an issue. We've had our issues. We had our fights. But we never separated. We never got divorced. We stuck together this whole 15 years. I said, okay, great. Tell me, investing. How long have you been investing for? We've been investing for about 8 years consecutively in my 401k, and my Roth IRA, and HSA consecutively, consistently. Okay, cool. So you got 15 years married, 13 years saving, 8 years you've been investing. Take the three, you divide by three. Husband and wife, you have an average commitment level of 12 years for any particular thing you do, whether it's spiritually, emotionally, physically, financially. Based on your track record, on the questions that I've asked about your savings consistency, your investing track record, your marriage track record, that's personal, your physical health track record, right? How long have you consistently maintained your weight? Have you ever been overweight? Have you ever been underweight? Or have you been consistent? Never really, like, you stayed at a healthy weight. Have you ever had any major health issues? Okay, so how long have you maintained a particular diet? How long have you been a vegan for? I've been a vegan for 20 years. Okay, so you've got these commitment levels in these other areas. And what I do is I take those and I find a median number across the husband and wife, or if I'm just dealing with a single person, just looking at the man or just looking at the woman, right? And I say, okay, mom, you got three kids, okay? You've been raising these kids alone, by yourself, single mom. You've done it successfully. All three kids never went to jail, never been, they went to school, they got degrees, they're all out of the house now. It's just you, mom. So if you successfully raised three children in your kingdom, wonderful. And you gave them three meals a day, shelter, food, water, all that, wonderful. And you've been saving for 12 years and da-da-da. So you've got an average commitment level of 17 years. Wonderful. That means that I'm comfortable writing you or helping you design a policy where we fund it at the least 17 years, because that's your average. Anything above that number, you're now setting an expectation. You're now raising the bar to say, my commitment level is 17 years. My commitment level is 12 years, average, based on all the things I've done in my past. But I would like to fund this policy for at least 25 years. Okay, so if we only want to do it for 25 years, she's like, no, Denzel, actually, I want to go for 25 years, but I want to have the ability. I want to be strapped to a high premium. I know I can do 25 years, but I want the ability to go an additional 10. I say, okay. So we design a policy where we can max fund the policy for 25 years and then go an additional 10 if we so please, but we're not obligated to, we're not strapped to, it's an option. What does that allow us to do? That allows us to, continue to fund the policy long-term. And then we come up with the number, right? We compare your commitment level and then we add the number up. So let's say your commitment level, everybody in here, let's just say I did this exercise with you, and your average commitment level is 15 years, and you're gonna put in the same number I'm doing, 70 grand a year into a policy. 15 times $70,000 is $1,050,000. Okay, so now you ask the question, how likely is it, Denzel Rodriguez, Samantha, Mary, Joe, Sue, Tom, Phil, how likely is it for you, mom, dad, right? How likely is it for you, mom? Let's say I'm talking to a mom. Say, mom, 45 years old. How likely is it that you're going to get in $1 million tax-free principal into this policy over the next 25 years? Well, Denzel, based on my track record, very possible. I said, okay, let's go. Let's get started. Now, if her commitment level was over 25 years, but I designed her a policy only paying in 10, then I would be doing a disservice to her as a coach, as a consultant, as a strategist, and as an insurance agent. I should encourage her to go longer. If she's like, oh, I just only want to do 10 years. I say, why is that, mom? You have a track record of saving for over 10 years, an investment track record of over 15 years. You ran a business for 9 years straight. Your average commitment level is 14 plus years. Why do 10? At least do 14. And then give us the ability to go longer, an extra 7, extra 10. Just in case you lock in that health now, you have the ability to fund the policy longer period of time and get that ideal number that you want. Is it 1 million, is it 1.5 million? And so when you do it that way, and this is my process, this is just me, I don't know if anyone else is doing it like this, it's just me. Worst case scenario, you 10X your income, you've got more money to put into life insurance, you got more money you don't know what the heck to do with. Worst case scenario, you start a second policy. What's the problem with that? Worst case scenario, you start a policy on husband, you start a policy on wife, you start a policy on all the kids, on the grandkids, mom and dad. Right? You go up or you go down. Better to go down because older, they're older and it's more expensive, but you go down and then you come back to the head, right? Husband or wife, and you restart, right? And you just keep restarting. In terms of the amount of policies, you could end up with 10, 20 different policies across a family of 5, 7, you know, people, right? So I don't think it's that bad if you fund a policy according to your commitment level first, prove that you can actually do this and have the least amount of premium required for that time frame, just the time frame, with an ability to maybe go a little bit longer. And then if you 2x, 3x, 4x, 5x, 10x your income over that 5-7 year period, okay, we start another policy. And now you know, oh, Denzel, I 10x'd. So I've got 8 times the amount of cash flow and 7 times the amount of cash flow now where we can go on a rampage. And I want to fund this thing till age 100. Okay, what is the risk in that? You don't actually live that long and you're paying for a premium to supply that. May not be in your best interest. Or maybe it is, because you're saying, well, Denzel, I got a long history of grandpa, grandma, mom, dad, they all live past 100. Average lifespan in my particular household is over 95. You can do an average lifespan based off your previous generations. That can help you determine the mortality rate in your specific household. And then you can look at the general culture. You can say, okay, as a Hispanic, the average life expectancy of Hispanics is 81. Okay, so maybe I fund the policy up until 81. And then anything after that is a little extra. I leave a little extra room for that. So many different ways that we can do it, right? We can have a ton of fun. With that being said, my name is Denzel Rodriguez, your personal finance geek of the 21st century. Click the links below because we cover so much on this channel. There's a lot of different resources. I want to give praise and glory to all the other infinite banking players in this space, the competitors, the ones that hate me, that don't like me. Hey, I love you. Thank you for all the business you sent me in the first place. Thank you. You're helping me get paid at an exponential rate. And I'm only 25 years old. I just got done doing $1 million in revenue to date. God bless. I don't know many Puerto Ricans, many Colombians that are operating at this level. So I'm blessed beyond measure. I'm getting in rooms that I shouldn't even be in. I'm not qualified. But I represent the kingdom of heaven here on earth, and he's doing everything. He's got like this, you know, God himself is just doing, you know, moving things around. He's protecting me. He's making sure I stay nice and healthy in this chaotic environment that we're in today in the 21st century. He's keeping me nice and healthy, my voice nice and clear. Man, I feel the Holy Spirit running through me all the time when I'm doing these videos. And as long as I stick to my purpose and walk in that, I cannot fail. And I agree with that for you as well. If you walk in your purpose, you walk in your gift, you will get paid at an exponential rate. Your gift will make room for you in this economy, and you can succeed. If I can do it, I know you can do it. God bless. Have a wonderful day, and we shall talk soon.